Good afternoon, good evening, or good morning, depending on where you are joining us from out there in the world. I'm Drew Altdoerffer, product manager here in Copenhagen, Denmark at Phase 1. I wish I could say it's a lovely day, but the weather's terrible, which is okay, because now we're here doing this.
Yeah.
And when I say we, I'm joined by Sebastian Sardi. You are a technical supporter here at Phase 1, but I guess more importantly, in the grand scheme of things, you are a photographer.
Yes.
And you've been at this little hobby of photography for how long now?
Yeah, well, I wouldn't call it a hobby, but
okay.
But
all
yeah,
right.
I've been doing this for since I was 19.
Right.
I think,
when you're 67 years old now.
I'm 67. I'm 35.
35. Okay. Yeah. Good. So we're joined by Sebastian so that we can talk about photography. I think a lot of these webinars, we're going over very technical aspects of the camera system, feature-orientated deliveries of all sorts of things with R&D, but these are the very fun webinars where we just get to talk about photography. And it's very simple for me, it's very simple for you, and I hope it's going to be simple for everybody out there to join along, follow along, ask questions. This is a very give-and-take webinar, so Sebastian, we're going to talk about your photography, and specifically we're going to talk about your medium format photography. Now, before you started working at Phase 1, which was years ago, you were a photographer, you were interested in photography, but were you shooting with medium format at the time?
I did not shoot medium format at that time. I was shooting with a 35mm film, actually.
Yeah.
So I'm from the School of Analogue Photography, so that was
great
where
school,
I was
a fantastic
brought up.
School.
Yeah.
And that led you into being a technical supporter for digital photography here at Phase 1.
It did, yeah.
Yeah.
Eventually you have to, you know, switch up in life and, you know, do the proper stuff. So, yeah, I switched to digital and I don't regret it, actually.
Right, that's good.
Even though I thought I never would, but yeah.
Yeah, I think we all had that moment of we're never leaving film, and
yeah.
then something happened.
Yeah,
but you know, you had these very extensive photo assignments that you were giving yourself. Really, just things that you were interested in. You've been to Chernobyl. You've been all over the place, really, photographing. And what we're showing here, this is your work. This is part of your Black Diamond book, which you've just had published.
Yes.
And this is all shot to where?
This is all shot in India.
And it's over the course of?
Yeah, it's over the course of, well, of 5 years. The photography part has been for 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
Then the actual making of the book took, well, over a year, actually.
Right.
So this is from the beginning of the first picture I took up until the actual book was made and finished.
Mm-hmm.
It took about 5 years.
And in that five-year period, I mean, this whole project you shot with medium format.
Yes.
And you shot it with film in the beginning. You had a Hasselblad 500, right?
I never shot in India with the Hasselblad. I used a Yashica, actually locally purchased in Kolkata. So that was the first camera I used when I went to the mines in India. But
and that was a twin lens reflex?
Yes.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're out there with film in the beginning.
Yeah.
Then over the course of that time, you got the job at Phase 1 and then, of course, had access to all sorts of stuff from us.
Yes, it's a benefit of working here that you can borrow the stuff that comes out and
right.
Obviously use it for your own purposes. And that's what I did when I started here. So before I started, I used Analogue. And then, obviously, it's an upgrade once you see the stuff that comes out of these machines.
Right.
So at that point, I actually switched from film to digital. And, well, the second time I went to India was with a IQ 180.
And so you were shooting that on a Contax, right?
Yes, Contax.
Right, so you had the Contax and the IQ 1, the 80 megapixel.
Yeah.
And then the subsequent times you went back, you were shooting on the 100.
Yes.
Yeah. So you kind of had a mix of all the different camera systems, but all of them medium format.
Yes.
And is there a specific reason why medium format is really what you chose for this project? I mean, your book is beautiful, but it's not a huge coffee table book.
No.
And I guess the intended final result was these big prints?
Yep. Yep.
And so how big are these two prints?
That's 1 by 1 meter.
Right.
So, and this one is 90 by 90 centimeters.
So even at this scale, I mean, these aren't even up-resed.
No.
So when you went and did this project, you had this scale in mind?
Well, at that time, not really. I didn't know when I started, I mean, what kind of, if I was going to do prints or large prints or whatever. I just felt an interest in the subject matter, and I wanted to see what came out of it. So at that point, as shooting with film, and I didn't really think about the end result as a huge print,
right,
like a massive one. So this is just a very positive byproduct of
fringe benefit of shooting all that resolution.
Yeah.
But I mean, you did deliberately choose medium format. You could have gone there. Why don't you tell us a little bit about this location?
So this is northeast India, close to the border of Nepal. It's in a state called Jharkhand, and it's one of the biggest, coal mining district of India.
Mm-hmm.
So this is open cast coal mining, and it's there is over 40 open cast coal mines. It used to be also underground mining, but they closed down the underground mines.
However, so now they're all just trenches.
Huge holes,
huge pits
in the ground.
Yeah.
And people work there under very hard, conditions.
Mm-hmm.
And that was something that I wanted to explore, and that was something that I got an interest for before I actually went to India. So this project, the Black Diamond project, is limited to about 5 years, but before I went to India, I went to, as you mentioned before, I've been to both Chernobyl, I've been to China to visit coal mines, I went to Kazakhstan to visit coal mines, and also in Russia I've been to coal mines. So I've been doing some work on mining before I started with the Black Diamond project.
Right.
And that eventually led up to me going to India and then going back and back. So I revisited India to, explore this specific place. This place is called Jharia.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of known for a bad environmental byproduct of underground fires. So there's been underground fires in this area for over 100 years.
Mm-hmm.
So there are actually, open fires, that kind of flames coming out of underneath the ground. So.
Right. And that's all the coal that's just been caught on fire.
Yeah, so it can self-ignite, or it can be, lightning strikes or people throwing a cigarette or stuff like that. So it's been burning and it's been spreading, and it's not been put out because of the mining companies or the government are, saying that we cannot put the fires out. It's so difficult because it's underground and spreading in ways that we cannot foresee or we cannot know. And so it's spreading underneath villages, and it's spreading in underneath where people live and commute and roads, and that makes parts of villages and roads collapse into holes that are essentially created by these fires.
Right.
So people then argue against the government that you just want to extract the coal from underneath our villages and underneath our roads. So you just let the coal burn, so we have to relocate ourselves so you can then reach the
excavated
coal.
So I mean, all of these images, they're not only, just aesthetically striking, and as you mentioned, all the fires and the horrible atmosphere really lends itself to this stark beauty in all the images, but there's a political aspect
for sure.
The entire thing. And that's
very much
really what drove you all the places you've been.
Yeah.
I mean, none of them are politically neutral places for you to be photographing. I mean, they all come with an agenda of trying to expose a story.
Yeah, yeah.
And the previous locations that you were in, you were shooting with 35 millimeter.
Yes.
And did you have medium format? Did you use it at all in the other locations?
I did not. It's been kind of a mix of what I've been using. So the first mine I visited was in China, and that was with a small 35 millimeter analog camera.
Right.
And so the second time I went to Kazakhstan, and then I had a digital camera. So that kind of differentiates between two cameras. So you kind of get a different end result from these two machines. Right.
You don't really have the consistency because you're shooting with two different.
And
systems.
I wasn't thinking about consistency. I wasn't thinking about doing something big. Work about this.
Right.
And then when I went to Murmansk, I went to Russia to a nickel mine.
Mm-hmm.
Then I was actually using a medium format film again.
Right.
So I kind of threw away my 35 millimeter full frame DSLR, a digital one, because I didn't really like the
quality of the images. Yeah.
And I kind of went back to film. And so that made all my previous work very inconsistent in regards to looks and feels and material. And when I went to, after that, when I went to India the first time, I thought, you know, I have to, you know, somehow limit myself or narrow down what I want to do. So I focused on the medium format part as mainly as a square, you know, like
right.
as coming from analog photography, using the Yashica or an old Hasselblad, you get a 6x6 format,
right.
Which was something I also used in my previous work with the circus. So my previous work with the circus, I did 35mm and 120mm film, 6x6, side by side in the book. So that worked out pretty well. But then I, and the images are kind of different as well. So
right.
my whole workflow and my whole process with the images is, my motive and how I frame and shoot is very different from small cameras to medium format cameras.
Yeah, and I think that's an important topic. I mean, your workflow, you know, just the speed at which you're going to work, and just overall the hardware you're going to have with you is going to be very different just shooting 35 millimeter versus medium format.
Yeah.
Now, once you got into medium format film, I mean, there was no going back.
No.
I mean, you have that aesthetic, not just the crop, but also the resolution and even the film files, the shallow depth of field, you know, forced perspectives, the different optics. You have all of this that's night and day in terms of the kind of the feel of 35 mil.
Yeah.
So once you're in medium format, then that's you can't really go back.
Exactly.
And then, you know, this job, you started it with film, and then you progressively moved into digital with all the hardware that you borrowed from us and brought it to some pretty terrible locations in terms of what's good for the health of a camera system. So dusty, dirty. But I mean, not a problem.
No.
No, with the contacts that you had with the XF that you brought later and the 100 megapixel, I mean, all those things worked out.
Yep.
I think we had to do some cleaning when that those systems came back here.
Yeah. Also benefit of being able to do that here, not being having to pay for it.
Yeah. We worked that out different ways. There's fringe benefits, but the equipment survived.
Yes.
That's always the good part. But now the aesthetic of all of that those images. You know, now that you have this consistency of medium format in this project, you talked about your previous projects where you're mixing 35 millimeter and medium format. With this one, with the Black Diamond project, it's all medium format.
Yeah.
And so when you put that body of work together, you know, to actually make the book and have the print series, I mean, what were you looking for in the actual aesthetic of the work so that, you know, it kept that consistency? You have some film, you have some 80 megapixel resolution and some 100 megapixel resolution images.
I think that's kind of a difficult part of it because all of these have to kind of blend and mix well together.
Right.
So also in the book, I've mixed black and white with the color.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, I think what keeps the flow is kind of the framing. I tend to obviously put things in the center,
right.
which is, well, an easy way to do it, I guess, when shooting in a square like that.
In a square, yeah, sure.
But other than that, I've tried to somehow align it in terms of contrast and in terms of depth of field, I guess.
Right.
To get it somehow
and
aligned
the optics
with film.
That you're using. If you started with that Yashica, was that a fixed lens on that Yashica?
That's a fixed lens, yeah.
And it's a 50 or a 35.
I think so. I don't know actually. Yeah.
But then you're kind of stuck into that format for the rest of it. So you didn't bring a whole bunch of lenses. You were really shooting with one or two different lenses. The 80, I would assume.
Yeah, the 80 and the 55. I've shot with. With the Yashica, I actually purchased it in Kolkata on secondhand market, so I didn't really know if it would work.
Right.
I just figured, if I'm going to this place, I have to bring a camera with me, which I did, and I managed to get some film in Kolkata, which is a difficult, very difficult thing to do, especially medium format. But and with the film I got, I couldn't really choose. You know. Pick a film, I just got whatever I came across.
You could get, yeah.
So I got expired slide film and I got some negative film as well. So the analog part of it also mixes in color and black
right.
and white. So already from scratch, I had black and white and color.
Right, and that was really setting the tone for this project.
Yes.
And then when you revisit with the digital camera systems, you know, then of course you can't shoot square, so you have to crop in on the image and kind of, you know, do that while you're composing your images. Keep that in mind. Maybe mask out the viewfinder. Your colors then have to be edited to match the film that you were using.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that really set the aesthetic. So your book does have a very film aesthetic throughout, even though most of it is digital.
Yeah.
There are some images, but they're very hard to find which ones are film and which ones are digital.
Yeah.
So, you did a great job in that regard.
Yeah, thanks.
But the digital ones then kind of match that film aesthetic, which I think is fantastic.
Yeah, you work a lot on that, on getting the colors and the separation of colors and just the general tonality of the picture,
right?
Which was very, very difficult with the slide, expired slide film, which is all over the place.
Right, that's not exactly easy to color balance.
No, so, you can take that upon you as a task to find those images in that book and see if you can.
Right, it can be like a Where's Waldo hunt.
Yeah, exactly.
Find the film images.
Yeah.
But then, when you came back with all these images, with the shoot to put the body of work together, printing all of a sudden became a pretty big reality for you. We're lucky enough to have a printer over here that's stocked with paper and ink. And so going through that process of actually, getting these things out of your computer and printing them, which is very rare these days, that became a fundamental core of you finishing this project.
Yep.
And the results are, you brought some in today, bless you for bringing these giant prints over from Sweden, but they're incredible. They're striking. And I think, one of the most important things that I could emphasize here that I hope anyone watching this takes home is to print your work. So much of our work now is on our phones, it's on our computer, and it never leaves those digital environments. But here you are standing in front of your work, giant 1 meter prints, and it gives me a bit of peace knowing that all that hard work went into creating this image, and now here it is.
Yeah.
Instead of just looking at it on my phone and scrolling by it.
Yeah, that's an important part of it, I think, because with today's flow of images just passing by all the time.
Right.
If you revisit your images, or if you constantly work on them, or if you're doing a book, you have to revisit them and try to align them or try to match them and try to get it working in a good flow. That is the same thing with a print. So once you've printed it big, you'll eventually, or you'll probably revisit it every time you look at it. So the more you revisit it digitally in your computer and see that this or this part or that or this thing needs to change,
right?
The more likely you'll end up with a good print that once you revisit, you'll find that it's still very nice, because I've been looking at it already 10,000 times.
Right.
So hopefully I don't see anything wrong with it this
time. You had those working prints. When after you did your initial edit in Capture One and you made some prints, we had some tacked up in the office that people would walk by and comment on. You were soliciting everyone's input, how's the color for this? How's the sharpness for this? Do these match in terms of the aesthetic? And that, being a digital photography company, but being a company that's filled with photographers, it was fantastic for everybody at work to just walk down the hall and see your images out on a table and, put some post-it notes on it to make suggestions. And now we come to see the final result and your final book. And that's, having those working prints is so important in the entire process.
Yeah.
Because seeing them on your computer all the time, that's one aspect of it. But then you need to make a print and revisit it and look at it and change things and make a new print and replace it.
Yeah.
And it's a process. It takes a while.
It's a process. And I think when you do this, you also kind of narrow yourself in a way. Mm-hmm. So it was important to me to get some feedback to kind of see outside my own frame or outside my own box, to get some input from you guys. All my friends over here.
Yeah, there's no shortage of opinions here at Phase One in terms of photography.
Exactly. To get a valuable input. And I asked you as well, this is make a selection and then narrow it down.
Right.
And then pick one that you like as your favorite one and pick one that you'd like to remove.
Right.
And then kind of motivate what's wrong with it or what's good with it.
Yeah.
So doing that with like 10 people will get you a lot of valuable input, like, oh yeah, maybe you got a point.
Yeah, yeah.
And all this talk about killing your darlings and all that stuff.
Yeah, which we did disappoint you quite a bit on some of those images, but that critique phase was, it was great for everybody here.
Yeah, man, it was very good for me as well.
Yeah, and again, the end result is striking. You have these big, beautiful, fantastic prints that, that aesthetic that medium format gives you, where you have that very shallow depth of field, and we'll go over some of your images that you've been kind enough to bring over. But just in the print, the depth of detail that's in, you know, all of this foreground and in all the faces of the subject matter, that very, very shallow depth of field. You know, you were shooting this a lot at dusk.
Yeah.
And you're hand-holding most of it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, not easy conditions to be using medium format. It would have been much easier to just have a small, you know, like a point and shoot, but
yep.
the images would reflect the amount of effort that you put into it. If it was yep. a simple and easy click, well, that's the snapshot you're going to get. These are carefully composed and thought through images. And I mean, we're so happy to see them in large scale print. They're yep. fantastic.
I think that workflow, the slightly slowed down workflow that you actually take your time with your subject, also kind of differentiates documentary work, because documentary photography work you often see very fast paced.
Yeah, photojournalism
things happening
is,
all the time
right.
and
being prepared for anything and making yeah. sure your camera's pointed in the right direction yeah, with I the mean, right settings.
It doesn't have to be sharp or it doesn't no. even have to be. It's a lot about composition and angles and
right.
This medium format camera actually slows me down from that, so
right.
I don't have to be that fast.
And you were shooting with the waist level.
I'm shooting with the waist level. So I enjoy shooting with the waist level.
And you're very tall.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the images are still going to be, for everybody, all of your subject matter, they're still going to be at, like, face height, but you're...
Yeah, and if I hold it here, it gets me also more stability.
Yeah.
As opposed to holding it and blocking my face. If I hold it here, I can still have kind of a contact with you.
Right.
And I could shoot and, you know, autofocus on you and then shoot you with the, right. without you even noticing me
yeah.
just clicking the trigger. And that is part of... my workflow as well in this case, or how I shoot, or how I take my pictures. So
yeah, how you're engaging with those subject matters.
Yep.
I mean, you know, you have to get these guys to kind of cooperate with you. I'm sure language was a barrier.
Yep, for sure.
But you know, by having that camera system not in front of your face, you can still have that conversation. You know, get them to kind of follow your sign language and do what you want while you're framing the image and take
yep.
the shot.
Yep.
And you know that shallow depth of field that I keep coming back to. I think. When I saw your images, when we went through them in Capture One, you know, that's one view of the images. And it's a small screen, and we can zoom in and look at all the detail and be impressed with it. But once you get into these big prints, you know, the softness of that depth of field, the sharpness and the contrast between your subject matter and the background, you know, just getting that that kind of bokeh, that soft depth of field, just to the right degree, where you can still see what's going on, but it's not distracting.
Yep.
I mean, it's a whole different view and a whole different look and a whole different engagement with the photograph once it's printed.
Yep. It's definitely a characteristic of the medium format, I'd say. And it's once you use it, it also pops out your motive in a way,
right.
obviously. The sharpness versus the soft bokeh will have, it's a contrast in the image itself.
Right. It gives it some depth.
Yeah.
Yeah. Really some separation of your subject. Well done.
Thanks.
Let's actually go into Capture One, and you have the images from your book.
Yep.
And let's just go over a few of the, kind of just the aesthetic of some of these images. So, these, you don't have to point out the ones that are film versus the
all
ones
right.
that are digital,
yep.
If you don't want to. I mean, we have some of the metadata here,
yeah.
so we can
yep.
see it. This one shot at ISO 200.
Yep.
But I mean, you know, these images, when you're shooting with medium format, you know, there's the workflow aspect of actually using such a big camera, a slower camera, and engaging with your subject. But, you know, when it comes to something like this, are you... finding this guy and having him sit down and posing him, or are you?
No, I don't pose people. So typically in a scene like this, there are probably 15, 20, or 30 people
yeah.
around working. And this guy maybe took a 30-second, 1-minute break
right.
and sat down. So me doing my thing, I typically try to make the frame look simple, you know,
right.
Make it clean and not too much going on. So even though around this scene there's probably plenty of things going around,
right,
I just found this guy sitting there,
right.
and I, you know, over a 250th of a second, I took this picture.
Mm-hmm.
So none of these people posed for me in that sense that I tell them to do things, or tell them to sit down, or tell them to do
whatever. Right, you're just kind of finding them, and then you're composing and framing out all the other chaos so we can concentrate on this guy. And you're shooting at f4 with the 80mm lens, and if we, you know, this is a good example of just that depth of field fall off. We have his hand, which is nice and sharp.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can really see, you know, hands always tell a story.
Yeah.
And with this guy, you know, you can see that his are hard working hands. But then you have, you know, against all the soft, out of focus area, you know, that depth of field fall off is pretty stark with that 80mm at f4.
Yeah.
So, you know, him as a subject is really just kind of popping off.
Yeah.
Of that that background. And if we go into, you know, most of these are, this is one that I really like with, you know, just the, there's the photojournalist aspect of this where, you know, these kids are working in this coal mine.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a real emotional engagement just seeing kids that are, you know, filthy and working hard, and, you know, that's part of what your book is about, is just kind of exposing all this.
Yep.
But when you come to just the aesthetic of this image, I mean, these two boys might as well be twins.
Yeah, they are.
Well, there you go. And, you know, again, just having this this just incredible detail with that camera system so that you can really see, you know, this could be a portrait of this young man against all that nice, soft depth of field fall off.
Yeah.
And now, I mean, in terms of the editing, you know, how close to this is the color and the render of those files? I mean, of course, you're going to do some post-processing, but as we mentioned, you started with film.
Yeah.
And, you know, the look and feel and aesthetic of film is going to be decided by some scientist in a factory.
Yep.
Either in Rochester, New York, if it was Kodak film, or in Japan,
yep,
if it was Fujifilm. But, I mean, that person is deciding the aesthetic of your film.
Yep.
When you're shooting with digital, you get to decide the aesthetic of the film, the aesthetic of the image. But, you know, to what degree is that reflecting reality? Was it that stark? Was it that moot landscape?
The landscape is very, very gray and dull because of all the dust and coal dust. Right. However, because of all the pollution that comes out when the sun goes up or sun sets down, this pollution or all this dust is lit up in a very special way, as you know, it does when you have the sunset.
Mm-hmm.
And that in India or in generally in this place, you get a very special color or tonality to the pictures. It kind of adds to this apocalyptic landscape or feeling,
in a sense that it's apocalyptic.
It kind of burns. This image here is in a coal pit, so it's obviously very gray and black, but in India a lot of people wear a lot of color in their clothing, so still I tend to desaturate a lot of clothing or color in general, also to match it a little bit more towards the black and white shots that I have, so it doesn't contrast too much from color and black and white. But in this case, all images have been desaturated slightly.
Mm-hmm. Even from the film scans? I mean, the scans of your film would have been desaturated? Because, I mean, here you have this woman who's clearly posing for you, but she's got, you know, some pretty vibrant attire. But, you know, you're going to be desaturating that and bringing that down so that it's matching with a bit more of the rest of the aesthetic?
Yes.
And again, I mean, most of these portraits, you know, they are very, very simple. Everything is a square format, right? You don't have anything that deviates from just a square crop.
In the book, there are some landscape shots that fill out the entire spread, but...
Mm-hmm. And I mean, most things are, you know, you have a centered subject matter that's sharp, and then the rest of it, you're shooting at very, very shallow apertures to try and separate the subject matter from the background.
Yeah.
And there's a few in here, if we skip forward a little bit, that, I mean, here's the shed shot, which is, of course, my favorite. But there's a few that you do have, you know, more of the landscape that you were in.
Yep.
So when we move over to some more of the landscape images, I mean, clearly the landscape is, there's certainly a reason why you were there, right? The landscape and the terrible conditions that it's in are what drew you there. But the people, or what you're trying to convey in the book. You know, there is a political aspect of your book, which we don't need to get into, but there is, you know, using the tools, using the medium format camera system, you could have taken this shot with any camera, right? Because this isn't specifically a beautiful landscape image. This is a documentary image of the actual scene. But when you're shooting it with the medium format digital camera system, you're giving yourself all of this latitude and leeway to edit the image, to, you know, crop in really tight if you wanted to print really big to match the rest of it. It's safe to say you didn't know how this was going to end up at the end, but you needed all that flexibility, you know, when you captured the image so that you could, of course, go back and change and edit everything to match your final result.
Yeah.
Is that fair to say?
Yeah, for sure.
Because a lot of your images of the landscape, they, of course, set the scene for how awful this place is.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, this one is it's an incredibly striking image because it is so atmospheric and there is so much depth to this image. I mean, you know, just zooming in 100%, you can see these people living in these conditions.
Yeah.
From afar, this image is just very dark and drab and desolate.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's life in this image. And of course, being able to show that life, if you're gonna print this very large, you know, there's a pig in the background, there's people brushing their teeth down by that little trickle of water. You know, you need to capture all of that detail. And if you had done this just to set the scene with your iPhone or with a 35 mil, all of this detail's lost.
Yeah.
All of that aesthetic and that depth to the storytelling of your entire project gets lost.
Yeah.
And so I think, you know, just the landscape aspects alone, you've mentioned that you're not exactly the most keen landscape photographer.
No, and I mean,
it's not your passion.
It's not my passion. I wish I was better at it, and I'm trying to get better at it. But in a case like this, it's important for me to see that you can go into the detail, especially if you're doing a big print like this that mm-hmm. actually enables you to explore the print so much more.
Right.
So if you're having this in a computer, you're just going to zoom in and zoom out because it's not going to fill your screen.
Right.
But if you're making a large print, then you'll be able to get the depth of it in a different way because you're seeing the landscape around it.
Right.
And then you're seeing what's inside of it, and you can go in and see the details.
Right.
So you can
really
see the pig, or you can see the people brushing their teeth, so there's so much detail that you can go over, and you can see new things every time you go into it.
You get to explore that image once it's a print that matches these other prints, these 1 meter prints. Now, I mean, you couldn't do that with a lower resolution camera system. I mean, irrespective of it being medium format or 35 millimeter or an iPhone, you know, if it didn't have the high resolution that you were using, you know, scenes like this would be lost.
Yeah.
Because once you put on a different lens, you know, a 120 or a 150, and you zoom in on this, you lose kind of the reference point of this image. Once you put on a shot with an 80, you know, now you actually have a reference point for the image. You can zoom in and see all that detail. When you print this and you print it big, now all of a sudden the viewer can explore this and find these hidden details. Because at a glance, no one's going to see this pig. It's a black pig in a very apocalyptic black setting.
Yep.
But once it's printed, now all of a sudden that detail comes out, and that's that just, I think, adds to the overall, you know, the really engrossing aspect of your project.
Yeah. That's also a very good reason to make prints, I think, or very nice effect of making big prints, because if you just watch these images on a small screen or just flicker by or just browse through it, you won't see these details, or you won't be able to go in and see what's in the image. You'll just kind of quickly look at it, and you don't, you know, bother spending more time in
processing it.
Exactly.
Right.
So if you have a big print, you'll be able to see all that in one time and at once.
Right. So. And I think, you know, having that shot with a medium format camera system, shot with high resolution, now you have that ability to print that to actually explore.
Yep.
Because a lot of your other images, you know, they're very striking and very beautiful and very simple. You know, this image, if we shot this with a lower resolution camera system, you know, it would still be a very simple portrait of that gentleman. But once we use the medium format and we zoom in, now we can see all the wrinkles in his face, the details, all the dirt in his facial hair. And because it's medium format, now all of a sudden we have this very clean separation of the background, this beautiful bokeh that really helps him, you know, jump out against everything else. And as we've gone back to a few times, then we also have the flexibility and the latitude that you've had in editing these files, trying to go back and match kind of that film look with all that extra color and extra information. And I think some of these, I mean, you really did meet some striking characters. I mean, this image you have printed here is just such an amazing photograph. I mean, all aspects of this image, you know, it's so sharp, and you can see every line on this guy's face in the print. I mean, you can see every piece of detail. And then just the overall scene is, it's so disheartening. Yep. To see, you know, this scene, but it's so beautiful at the same time.
Yeah.
Now you have this very, it's just a gorgeous sky of what looks like a storm rolling through, and then just this just horrible but beautiful environment that this guy's in.
Yep.
And I think, you know, using that the camera system that you did, it's a slow camera system, so you can slow down your workflow, high resolution so you can get all that detail, beautiful optics so you can actually get that separation, that depth of field. You know, all of that really leads you to the entire project. You know, without that camera system, this project could have happened. You could have done this with any camera system, but it certainly wouldn't be the same. It wouldn't have that same feel and aesthetic.
No.
Are there any other images of note that you'd like me to reference?
These are the cover, front and back, first cover images. They're just kind of cutouts of the actual mines.
Right, that these people are working in.
Yeah. And then we have some bicycles, yeah.
I mean, again, just setting the tone for the image, you know, the hardware and everything that you're using aside, just the aesthetic of that image where you have most of it is soft, out of focus, very shallow depth of field, and just these three lonely bikes is, it's striking. It's great composition. It's a beautiful shot.
Thank you.
And so much of your book is just incredibly striking.
Thank you.
You know, this guy who's a... He's a great-looking guy. He's got earrings, but I mean, just the contrast of a beauty shot with someone that's just so caked in dirt and coal dust.
Well, this guy kind of stopped in the middle of his work. He was chopping up pieces of coal.
Mm-hmm.
I just said stop, and I took I think 3 pictures of him.
Mm-hmm.
And you can from this really see the. I mean, the coal dust, how it settles in your pores, on your skin, and this dust, it's really, it doesn't wash off that easily.
No, it's basically
goes in
tar.
Goes in your nose, goes in your eyes, goes in your ears, and it takes probably for me a week before everything is, you know, washed off.
Right.
And this thing goes into your lungs, and if you're working here, it sets on everything. I mean, everything.
Even the camera system.
Even the camera system.
Right.
So, yeah, with the camera system, that's a bit of a risk, I guess, when using a waste level finder, at least. I mean, I taped mine up so it wouldn't get too much dust in it, but the dust is so fine
that it finds its way
that it goes in, and it's like walking on a cloud in some places. They water it down with water, so it shouldn't be too dusty, but it's still with the dry, if it's dry season or if it's very warm, this just creates huge clouds that just everywhere you go, you just put dust on yourself.
But I mean, overall, the images are beautiful, your book's fantastic, and your prints are just tremendous.
Thank you.
So, in closing, I mean, thank you for sharing your project with us.
Thank you.
And bringing your prints in today. If you could just, you know, give me some insight and summary into really your workflow with the camera system. I mean, what is it about medium format that makes it makes the project what it is for you. I mean, clearly we've already talked about the other camera systems that you've used and the decisions that you've made, but you stuck with medium format for this project.
Yeah.
So tell me about, you know, your use of the camera system, the aesthetic that you get with the medium format, why it is you choose that, and then why printing is so important for you as an artist.
One of the main reasons why I really like this camera is because of I can use a waist level finder.
Mm-hmm.
And still, when using the waist level finder, I can get light mirroring from the XF body itself.
Right.
So it doesn't need me to have an external light meter, so I need to meter something and then check my values and then...
Right, sure just right. Simplifies it.
It simplifies it a lot, and being able to using the waist level finder makes me able to shoot from the center of my body.
From your belly button.
From my belly button.
Yeah. Right, photography from the belly button.
And to me, that makes me able to engage the subject in a different manner. Because a lot of people or a lot of photographers, they kind of tend to say that, yeah, at least I've got cover for my camera. I can hide behind my camera.
Right.
There's always something separating me. So I'm not there, but I'm there, but I'm not really there.
Right, it's protection.
Yeah.
You like to be exposed.
Yeah. Well, I think it's a benefit because once you see someone pick up a camera and aiming it at you,
a lot
of people react to that.
Right.
And if you don't do that, you'll be able to, well, I guess not sneak photography, but I guess you'll be able to take a picture that is somehow more honest because you're still interacting with the person.
Yeah.
And it doesn't them react to the camera in a specific
In your
way.
Case, I'm guessing that language was a barrier. Culture is a barrier.
It is, yeah.
So being able to engage with them through something just as simple as a waist level viewfinder.
Yeah.
You can use the camera system away from your face. You can engage with them and you can still operate everything and have the tools on hand that you need.
So for me, that is a major aspect in my type of shooting or the style.
It's just the workflow. I mean, having that as a workflow.
Yeah. And especially with, I mean, visiting these areas or traveling this far, I mean, you don't get there overnight and you have to walk around a lot and travel around a lot. So the waist level finder also makes the camera much lighter.
True.
Also, a reason why I'm using the 55 and the 80, this smaller lenses, so I don't have to carry that much. Everything I've shot is handheld, so I don't carry a tripod because it's not a super light camera.
But no.
It obviously gets lighter using a waist level finder or using the smaller lenses, which I find fits my type of workflow or my type of photography very well because traveling around, moving around a lot and carrying a lot of gear, everybody knows that's exhausting for you.
Right.
Especially if it's very, very warm or very humid.
Which I imagine it was here.
Dusty and climate is, you know, against you in every way.
Right.
Then making things as easy as possible for me is a key point in using this as well. So.
Right. And having the, you know, resolution is, of course, one aspect of it. And the resolution gives you the flexibility to make big prints or zoom in and have closer portraits. It, you know, it gives you workflow headroom, really.
Yep.
It gives you flexibility. But you didn't go into this thinking, I just need higher resolution. That's what I need.
Yeah.
I mean, you went into this knowing that medium format's going to give you a certain workflow. The camera system's going to give you a certain workflow.
Yes.
It's going to give you an aesthetic.
Yes.
And, you know, using medium format to achieve that aesthetic, to facilitate that workflow, the resolution's a great benefit.
Yep.
Because once you come back with those high-resolution files, now you can start doing all sorts of things.
Yep.
And one of those things is your prints.
Yep. The prints are a very important aspect, I think, with this type of work, because now it's final, and it kind of sets you up to display it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's becoming visual for a lot of people in an open kind of way.
Mm-hmm.
So these prints are, they convey a lot of the story. They say a lot just by either the scenery or the actual detail.
Mm-hmm.
And being able to use, I mean, if we're talking about resolution, being able to use this huge amount of pixels in a way that you can actually see the dust, how it settles in people's faces.
Right.
It's very striking once you see that.
It's much more engaging.
It's very engaging. It makes you maybe understand it a bit more.
Mm-hmm.
That, wow, this dust is really dirty and it really sticks to you. And
these prints are basically, they're not up-res. These are almost one-to-one.
Yeah.
So, I mean, this is a meter by a meter. and just being able to get as close as you want to this print and seeing every detail in this guy's face and, you know, all the dirt and all the wear and tear that he's put his body through. Having a print of the same size that's lower resolution, you would lose that engagement.
Yeah.
You would lose that aspect of really engrossing you in this image, because this that resolution invites me to explore every aspect of this this gentleman and this guy. And I love that print. It's fantastic.
And it's also like when you take a picture, you don't see all of the information which is in the picture. You kind of compose it and try to get it as good as possible in camera, but you don't see all that. But once you then make a print, or once you then zoom in, you'll discover so much more in there, mm-hmm. which at the moment you took the picture, you didn't see or didn't think about. And there's so much more in that picture afterwards, which is kind of, wow, I didn't see that. Or it kind of surprises you as well.
So right.
The amount of detail and the amount of things that is in the picture,
just all that information, all the story,
yeah,
that's in just one frame.
It blows my mind. It really, each time I revisit, I see something else,
and right.
you can look at different parts of it from time to time as well. So.
And I think that's that aspect of engaging with the photograph. You know, again, illustrates how important it is to print, because you know now you have this fixed image that you can actually need to move around, and you're not sitting there with your headphones on, panning around on your computer. I mean, it's really it's a very physical relationship between looking at this print and exploring it and finding yep. new aspects.
Yep.
The working prints that you had, finding areas that we need to improve, finding parts where the color looked odd, or maybe, you know, finding an area that we should just crop out. You know, I remember we talked about the power lines and everything in some of your images, which ones were detracting from the image, which ones were adding to it and giving it a place in time. That aspect of printing, I think, is incredibly important.
Yeah.
And I do think, you know, with your images, as fantastic as they are, they wouldn't be as interesting if they weren't shot with the high resolution with medium format. I think you did a fantastic job choosing the right tools, the simple tools, waist level viewfinder, standard lenses, the 55 and the 80. Keeping everything simple, but you know, as simple as you've kept it, the depth and detail that's in these images and the beauty that's in these prints is just fantastic.
Thank you.
No, thank you, Sebastian. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for bringing your work. Thank you for talking shop about medium format photography and the importance of print. And thank you for sharing all of your fantastic work with us.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us here on today's webinar. If you have any questions, please fire away. We'll be moderating the rest of the webinar for the next 10-15 minutes, so we can go over any questions that you might have. Again, Sebastian, thanks. Much appreciated.
Thanks.
Get out there, do a new project so we can have more good times like this
we'll
and
see
go
about
over
that.
Some work. All right, great. We'll see you on the next one. Thanks for joining us.